Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about the speed control of DC motors. So we have seen that the speed is proportional to EB by 5. So I can write this EB. EB is nothing but, let us take for example a shunt machine. So if you take a shunt machine, so this will be my field, this will be my supply voltage. So there will be armature current in this, there will be shunt field current in this. So this current ISH will be equal to V by RSH. So if you want to calculate EB, EB is the back EMF. The back EMF will be equal to V minus IARA divided by flux is 5 only. The flux depends on different parameters for different machines that we will see. So by controlling any one of these parameters, we can control our speed. So first thing is, I can control my flux. By controlling the flux, I can control the that one value. So that is called as flux control method. Similar way, I can control this IARA drop. I can insert some resistance here, in adding to REA some other resistance. So using that also, I can change the value of EB. Using that also, I can control my speed. So that is called as armature control method. And the third one is there, this voltage, whatever is the supply voltage or the voltage that is given across your armature, that voltage can also be changed. So using that also, we can control. So this is called as armature control. So this is the third technique, this is the second technique, and this one is the first technique. So let us see each one of them in detail now. So first one, I am starting with the flux control method. Flux control method, or it is also called as the flux weakening method. So we know the speed is proportional to EB by 5. If I can maintain my EB constant and only vary the flux, so then I can write as speed is proportional to, if I can maintain this constant, so speed is inversely proportional to flux. So we can control it by inversely controlling this. Let us take the example. By using something, if I decrease my field current, if I decrease my field current, because flux depends on the field current, so the flux will decrease. When the flux will decrease, what will happen to the speed? That speed will increase. So we can tell from here, this method is used for speed control above rated speeds. This is used for above rated speeds only. But there is a disadvantage of this method. By decreasing this flux, so the disadvantage is, as the flux is decreased, so automatically the effect of armature reaction. Armature reaction is the effect of armature flux on the main field flux. We have seen there that because as a result of this, the main field flux decreases. This leads to poor commutation. So the armature reaction effect is increased. So the armature reaction effect is increased, which leads to poor commutation. How armature reaction is not increasing, actually the effect of armature reaction, that means your net resultant flux will be equal to the main field flux minus the flux due to the armature. So flux due to the armature for a given load is constant. As this value is decreased, so automatically the resultant flux is decreased. So this leads to poor commutation. Because of poor commutation, what happens? There will be a sparking at the brushes. That is the only disadvantage of this technique. So now, as the flux is decreased, so what will happen to the speed? The speed is increasing, but we know the torque. Torque is proportional to phi into IA. For a given load, the IA is constant. So if the flux is decreased, what will happen to the torque? The torque is decreasing. That means, whenever the flux is controlled, the speed is increased and torque is decreased for a given current. Or I can tell that the speed is inversely proportional to torque. So if I draw my torque speed characteristics, so torque speed characteristics will come like this. This is my speed. As the speed is increased, so the torque will decrease. So I can tell that N into T is a constant. So N into T is a constant. We know power P is equal to 2 pi NT by 60. This is constant. These terms are already constant. So what will be the resultant of this? This power will be constant. So that's why, by controlling the flux control method, by flux control method, the machine acts as a constant power drive. Machine acts as a constant power drive. What is the constant power drive and other things we have discussed in last class? You have referred to our last class, that is lecture number 16. So let us see the control in each one of them, because till now we have not gone into details. So let us start with the shunt motor. So the shunt motor, just now I have discussed, this is my armature. So I want to control my field. So what I will do, I will insert some resistance in the field circuit. Let us assume this resistance in the field circuit is Rf. This is my ISH, this is my voltage V, this is my armature current, and this is my back EMF. Because armature current depends on the load, so armature current is independent of this. So when you are controlling the Rf, automatically the value of ISH will change, because the value of ISH is equal to V divided by Rf plus RSH. This RSH is constant, V is constant. So we can tell that ISH is inversely proportional to Rf plus some constant. So inversely proportional to this. So that means as you are increasing the resistance, the field current will decrease. When the field current will decrease, the flux will also decrease. So I can note down the ratio of the speed N2 by N1 is equal to Eb2 divided by Φ2. Sorry, this is N2 by N1, right? Eb2 by Φ2 multiplied by Φ1 by Eb1. Or otherwise, I can write N2 by N1 is equal to Eb2 by Eb1 into Φ1 by Φ2, where N2 is with Rf. Similarly, this Φ2 is with Rf, and Eb2 also is with Rf. Generally, the value of Eb2 changes little bit by changing the field, because the speed changes. So here, one thing I am doing, that the armature reaction is neglected. So this is the case for shunt machine. Let us see for the case of the series motor. So I am just discussing for series. So series motor, there are three different possible ways by which we can do this. So first one is using the field diverter. The name itself is telling, it diverts the value. So field diverter, so the circuit will be like this. This is my armature, this is my field circuit. So across your field circuit, I insert one resistance. So this resistance I am representing by RD. R suffix D stands for diverting resistor. Let us assume that ID is the diverted current, and this is the current to ISC, and armature current is IA. This is my supply voltage. So armature current, we know, depends on the load. So out of this armature current is dividing among ID and ISC. So how much value will be diverted will depend on the resistance. So how much value will pass through ISC? ISC will be equal to total current into other resistance. Other resistance or the second resistance is RD divided by total resistance. This we already know for parallel combination. So this will always be less than IA, because some current is always diverted. So automatically the speed also will be different. So let us try to calculate the speed. So I can write the speed N2, sorry, always I am writing N2. So N2 by N1 is equal to Eb2 divided by flux Φ2 into flux Φ1 divided by Eb1. I can write like this. So this I am just reformulating. This is Eb2. We know the flux Φ2. The flux Φ2 will depend on what is the value of ISC, how much value of the shunt, because using this formula we have to calculate, multiplied by flux Φ1 is because of the armature current, divided by Eb1. So this I can write as Eb2 by Eb1 into ISC by IA. This is the value of N2 by N. Remember here, where N2 is with diode. So let us see what will happen if I am increasing my value of RD. As the value of RD is increased, the amount of ISC will increase. So that means if I keep different values of RDs in such a way that RD1 is greater than RD2 is greater than RD3. So as the resistance is increasing, the automatically the current passing through ISC will increase. ISC 1 is greater than ISC 2 is greater than ISC 3. We know the speed is inversely proportional to current. So N1 is less than N2 is less than N3. Okay, this is the way the speed will come. So here also same thing, as the flux is decreased, only the speeds above normal speeds only are possible. Speeds above normal are possible. So let us see the second method. Second method is tap field control. So in the first method, actually there is one shunt resistance which is inserted. Continuously the current is passing through the shunt resistance. So automatically there will be a loss, ID square into RD. This much loss is continuously there, this much power loss is there. So that creates so much heat and unnecessary lose in the power. So to avoid that, we can go for second type of technique called as the tapped field control. So in the tapped field control, the field is tapped with a different tapping. So let us assume this is my series field winding. I am doing the tapping at different points. So let us assume this is 4, 3, 2, 1. So the supply voltage is given here. This voltage will be connected with the help of some lever. It can connect to 1, 2, 3, 4. So you can see when it is connected to 1, so the current is passing through the entire RSC. So automatically the flux is more. When the flux is more, automatically the speed will be less. So we can tell that N4 will be greater than N3 will be greater than N2 will be greater than N1. Okay, because as you are increasing the number of turns, automatically more flux is produced, so the speed decreases. So let us now go to series and parallel connections, the third type. Series and parallel connection. So in this, what we do, that field will divide into two parts. They can be either connected in series or shunt, by which we can control the speed. But here only disadvantage is only two speeds are possible. So let us assume I have divided them into two parts. Each one is having NSC number of turns. NSC number of turns. And this is connected to my supply voltage. So when it is connected to my supply voltage, the complete armature current will pass through them. The second possible connection will be, these two will be connected in parallel. So I am connecting them in parallel. This is NSC. This is NSE. This is connected to my voltage. This is my armature current. So this armature current will divide equally among these two. This will be equal to IA by 2. This will be equal to IA by 2. Let us see what is the MMF produced in first case. MMF is equal to number of turns into current passing through them. So number of turns are NSE and current passing through them is IA. Total 2 are there. So 2 into NSE into IA. So, whereas in the case of this MMF, in parallel connection I am representing with P, series connection I represent with S. So, this will be equal to NSE into IA by 2. Total how many are there? 2 are there. So, this will become equal to NSE into IA. So, this I can write as 2 times of NSE into IA. Or this I can write as 2 times of NSC into IA is MMF due to series connection. MMF due to parallel connection is half times the MMF due to series connection. So automatically MMF by reluctance gives my flux. So the flux produced by the parallel connection will be half times the flux produced by series connection. So automatically the speed is inversely proportional. So the speed in parallel connection will be 2 times the speed in series connection. So this is what we have observed, because speed is inversely proportional to the flux. So now let us go to the next technique, the armature resistance control. So before proceeding to that, let us try to summarize what we have studied. We have studied till now that in this case, as the speed is increased, the torque is decreasing, and we have seen that using the field control, the machine acts as constant power drive. Constant power drive, and the speeds above normal speeds only are possible. Above normal or possible. So let us now go to the next technique, that is armature resistance control. So armature resistance control method. So again, let us take the example of a shunt machine to analyze, and further we'll proceed with others. So let us assume this is my field. This is RSC. So this is my voltage. So this is my value of RSH. So this is my back EMF, and this is my armature. So you have to remember here, first thing, the armature current is only depending on the load. Armature current only depends on load. Depending on what is the load, accordingly the armature current depends. So with those basics, let us proceed. We know the speed is proportional to, let us assume the flux is constant because V is applied directly across RSH. So supply voltage is constant, flux is constant. Only variable will be V minus Ia Ra. So in this case, as I have inserted some resistance, this become V minus Ia into Ra plus Re or RSC, or so let us write Re only, because RSC we are using for series field, because that may create the problem. So now, as I am increasing the Re, what will happen? Ia into Ra plus Re, this value will increase. So what will happen to the result? So as a result of this, so V minus Ia into Ra plus Re, this resultant value will decrease. So when this resultant value decreases, the speed decreases. The speed decreases. So we can tell that this method is used for speeds below rated speeds, because the speed will decrease only, speed is not increasing rated speeds. So here one observation is there. In this method, the flux phi is maintained constant. So the effect of armature reaction is less in this case because the flux is not weakened. So automatically, when compared to the field control method, in this method, the commutation process is improved. There is no effect of the commutation problem. The commutation will be very good. That is the main advantage when compared to the field control method. So let us see about torque. So as the value of Re is increasing, the speed is decreased, but we know the flux phi is constant, and I have already discussed the Ia depends on the load, so that Ia also will be nearly constant, the variation is less. So we can tell that as the torque is proportional to phi into Ia, phi is constant, Ia is constant, so automatically this torque will be constant. Or this I can explain in some different way, since Ia is equal to V minus Eb divided by Ra plus Re. As Re is increased, then what will happen to the speed? The speed is decreased. When the speed is decreased, the Eb is decreased. So this gives rise to V minus Eb. V minus Eb will increase. That means when Re is increased, automatically this value is also increased. So this will nearly balance each other. Therefore, the value of Ia will be constant. Otherwise, you will get doubt. Eb is decreasing, so it will have the effect. So, this is the reason. So, we can tell that the torque T is constant. So, I am just summarizing this. In armature control method, the machine acts as constant torque drive. So what is constant torque drive, where it is used, this also we have seen in last class, please refer there if you have queries. So let us go to the shunt motor. Now going specifically to the shunt motor, so the shunt motor will have the field, just now we have discussed this, this is Re, there is armature, and this is my supply voltage. We know the speed is proportional to V minus IRE. And the speed in the second case with controller will be V minus Ia into Ra plus R. So I can tell from this, this N2 by N1 is equal to V minus Ia into Ra plus Re divided by V minus Ia Re, because the flux is nearly constant. Okay, if I neglect the effect of the resistance Ra, because generally the value of Ra is very less, Ra is very less, and can be neglected. So if we neglect this value, I can write my value of N2 by N1 is equal to V minus IA into RE divided by V. This I can write as 1 minus IA into RE divided by V. So we have seen the speed regulation in the last class. Speed regulation is the change in speed from when the load is suddenly removed, or it is nothing but the ratio of the speed regulation is the ratio of no load speed minus rated load speed divided by the rated load speed into 100. So that we have discussed already. So this value, this is the rated value and this is the value with the control. So that's why I have written it opposite. So similarly, this is with the rated value. So this I can write as 1 minus N2 by N1. So remember here, N2 is with the control and this is under normal conditions. So normally it is N1, so I will write N1s, because speed regulation we have seen in last class, the no load value minus full load value by full load value. So we have to take the rated value. So this is my rated value, this is my rated value. Because of controller, the speed is changed. So that's why I have written like this. So N2 by N1. So this I am substituting here, 1 minus IA RE divided by V. So this thing I have substituted here. So then this becomes IA into RE divided by V. So I can write that the speed regulation is equal to IA into RE divided by V. Okay, let us try to write the efficiency. Efficiency is equal to the power that is converted into mechanical form is EBIA that produces the torque divided by V into IA. So this I can write as EB divided by V. This is V minus IA into, if you are neglecting RA, so this become V minus IA RA divided by V. So this I can write as 1 minus IA RA divided by V. This is nothing but equal to N2 by N1. So this we have just derived. So efficiency is, we are getting as N2 by N1. So remember, this N2 is with controller using the resistor. N1 is the normal speed. So you can see, as you are inserting the resistance, so automatically the efficiency will change drastically. So let us see how it is going to affect. So I am going to draw the characteristics. So this is my value of IA, this is my speed. Ideally it should be constant, but practically this is with RE is equal to 0, grouping characteristics. So with RE, as the RE is increasing, the value will drop. This is RE1, RE2, RE3. So this RE3 is greater than RE2 is greater than RE1. So this is related to the speed. So let us take one example to clarify this. So let us take, if N1 is equal to 1000 RPM and N2 is equal to 700 RPM. So if you ask to calculate the efficiency for the shunt machine, I can just calculate N2 by N1. This will become 700 divided by 1000. So what will be the efficiency? 70%. So instead of this, if N2 is equal to 300 RPM, what will be the value? Efficiency will be equal to 300 divided by 1000. So this will become 30%. So you can see that as the speed is decreased, automatically the efficiency is falling down. Or we can tell that as the resistance value is increased, the efficiency is falling down. I can write like that. So I am just writing this as resistance is increased, the losses are increased, which leads to fall down of the efficiency. Okay, and the speeds also will drop because of this. So this method is used only for small machines, because if you are using this for small machine, large machines, then the efficiency will fall down drastically, particularly for the case of shunt motor. So let us see the case of series motor. So for the series motor, this is my value of RSC. So here I have inserted some external resistance RE. This is my value of IA. So same way, if you are inserting the resistance, so let us assume this is with Re is equal to 0. So as you are inserting the resistance, so same thing, same type of formula you can apply. So I can write my equation for N2 by N1 is equal to V minus Ia into Ra plus Rsc plus R external resistance divided by V minus Ra into Ra plus Rsc. If you are neglecting Ra and Rsc, again similar type of equation comes like before. So flux, I am assuming that flux is constant from no load to full load, but flux will vary in the case of series motor if the current is changed. For if the current is constant, the flux is constant. So I am writing the flux also here. The effect of flux may also be there. So let us try to draw the characteristics. As the resistance is increased, so this is armature current versus the speed. As the resistance is increased, we know the speed will decrease. So this is for Re1, this is for Re2. Re2 is greater than Re1 is greater than Re0. So same type of efficiency and other calculation will be there for the case of series motor also. So let us try to summarize for the case of armature resistance control method. In armature resistance control method, we have observed that the machines act as the constant torque drive, and the speeds below rated speeds only are possible with this, and the efficiency also falls down drastically. So that's why this method is only limited to small machines only. So let us see the another type of technique, voltage control method. So this voltage control method is mainly used in electric traction. And electric traction, we know we always go for series motors because we need high starting torque. So I am only discussing for the series motor for voltage control, as only series motors are used, not the shunt motors in this case. So let us assume the series motors are connected in parallel is the first case. The supply voltage is V. So out of V, automatically this voltage will be divided among this. This is V by 2 and this will be equal to V by 2. So second case, let us assume they are connected in parallel. If they are connected in parallel, entire voltage will be applied across your motor. So this is my supply voltage. So entire supply voltage will apply. So the armature current that is supplied is Ia here also, Ia here also. Let us see how it will divide. So first thing we have to remember that the motor output will be constant. That means we can tell that this V into Ia is equal to constant. Accordingly, draw the value of V or Ia. So in this case, we are controlling the voltage. So accordingly, Ia will be decided. Here the voltage applied across each machine is V by 2. Voltage across each machine is V by 2. Let us assume it is drawing a current of Ia. I am just comparing both of them. So here V into Ia by 2 is the power generated by the each machine. So same power will be generated in parallel connection also because load is same. So to get the same thing, V into Ia by 2, as the supply voltage is V, what will be the current through each one? Current through each one is Ia by 2. That is the reason I have written Ia in both the cases. So V into Ia or voltage into current will be constant because the load will be constant on the motors. So remember this. So I am just summarizing this. Series motor is a constant power drive. This we have seen the series motor characteristic. Constant power means the voltage multiplied by current will be constant across it. So let us proceed further. We know the speed is proportional to Eb by phi, which is equal to V minus Ia Ra divided by phi. As Ra is very less, so I am neglecting this. So this leads to V by phi. Everyone agree with me? So let us try to write for each case. So let us write for the first case. So in the first case, the speed is proportional to the voltage applied is V by 2 divided by the armature current is Ia. So I can write that the speed in series connection is proportional to V by 2 times of Ia. So let us see for parallel connection. For parallel connection, the speed is proportional to voltage applied is V and the current passing is Ia by 2. So we can tell that in parallel connection, the speed is proportional to 2 times of V by V. So we can compare these two. So I can write the ratio of NP by NS. If you calculate, you will get equal to 4. Okay, now let us go for the torque. Torque is proportional to phi into Ia. So torque is proportional to armature current square. So parallel connection, the torque is proportional to Ia by 2, because current is Ia by 2. So Ia by 2 square. So this will be, this is for the case of series connection. So for parallel connection, it will be 1 by 4 times of Ia square. So I can tell that the ratio of torque in parallel connection by series connection is equal to 1 by 4. So you can remember here, the ratio of the speed into torque is always a constant in a series machine. Okay. This way we can control using voltage control method. But so initially that machine, the motor will be connected in such a way. Initially I want more torque and less speed, because it starts initially from zero when it is starting in the station. So in which way we have to connect this? It should be connected in series. And once it picks up the speed, the motors will be connected in parallel. This is what is done in electric traction. So let us go now go to the another method which combines the features of both the field control and armature control, which is called as Ward-Leonard method of speed control. Ward-Leonard method of speed control. So this uses a different type of setup. So this is my bus bar. So there are one generator, which is a self-excited generator. I have made the winding. So this generator will be connected in such a way the field direction can be changed flexibly. So that I am representing here. There is a switch which can be reversed. So this will be connected here. This will be connected. This is connected to my DC supply. And this will be coupled, because this generator should rotate using something. So this will be connected to some prime mover. So generally we go for the induction motors, and in some specific cases only we go for synchronous motors. Induction motor advantage is the speed can be variable and it can withstand the load fluctuations. Whereas in the case of synchronous motor runs at the constant speed. It cannot control the variable speed. So that is a disadvantage of synchronous motor. But synchronous motor has its own advantage. It can improve your power factor. So let us assume this generator is supplying the voltage V. So this will be connected to one motor. So there is a motor here, DC motor. So this DC motor field is controlled using some series resistance. So RF, some series field resistance is there. So this is connected like this. So I can control this. So there are two controls. One is this control. Sorry, here I forget to represent. Here also one resistance will be there for controlling the flux for the case of generator. So this is the setup for Ward-Leonard method. So Ward-Leonard method, the advantage is it acts both as the constant torque variable power drive as well as constant power variable torque drive. So both are there. So this will be below rated speeds, this will be above rated speeds. So how it is below rated speeds, how it is above rated speeds, that we are going to see. So to get below rated speeds, so what should we do? We have just discussed that we have to go for armature control method. Armature control method means we have to control the voltage that is supplied to the armature. But inserting a resistance in the armature, we have seen the efficiency will fall down. Only option is control the supply voltage. That means I have to control this supply voltage. How can I control the supply voltage? I can control my generator field. By controlling the generator field, if the flux is decreased, so this, if this field current is decreased, so flux decreases, so automatically this generator voltage decreases or V decreases. When the voltage is decreased, automatically the speeds below rated speeds only are possible. So when the speeds below rated speeds are obtained, so we have seen there the power P, which is proportional to torque into speed. The speeds below rated speed as possible, and we know that it acts as a constant torque drive. We have just seen it, so you can refer there. Armature control method, the machine acts as a constant torque drive. So the power is directly proportional to the speed, in this case of below rated speeds. So if you want to control above rated speeds, we maintain our supply voltage constant. We can control this field flux of your motor. If you control the field flux of your motor, then automatically the speeds above rated speeds are possible. So when you are doing the field control, we have seen that the machine acts as a constant power drive and variable torque drive. This thing also we have seen before. So that means above rated speeds, so field of motor is decreased, and for above rated speeds the supply voltage is increased or decreased. Increased or decreased, we can increase or decrease it accordingly. I can get the speeds above or below rated speeds. So this we have already seen. So what are the advantages of this method and what are the disadvantages? So advantages is wide range of speed control is possible. So let us assume by using armature control, I can get up to 10:1, and by using the field control, because using the field control, the effect of armature reaction increases, so we cannot change more. So that's why let us assume it is 4:1. So by combining them in this world Lennon method, we can get the speeds in the ratio of 40:1. That is the advantage. And the second advantage is the efficiency is more. What is the reason? There is no resistance in inserted in armature circuit. As the resistance is not inserted, automatically the efficiency will be more. And the third one is its simplicity. It is very simple and easy to operate. But there is a disadvantage. The disadvantage is, first one is the high initial cost. The reason is we need three machines. One induction machine, one DC generator, and one DC motor. So three are required, so automatically initial cost increases. Second problem is the space required is more, and the third thing, as the number of machines are increasing, so automatically the maintenance also will increase. So these are the disadvantages. So but where they are used, the applications part of this constant power variable torque drive and constant torque variable power drive, we have discussed in last class. I am just repeating once again here. These are used in applications where you want the control in both the directions in a flexible way. The wide speed control is, range of speed control is required. So in those cases we go for this. The applications of this are the steel mills, then rolling mills, cement industry, electric excavators, etc. In these applications, we go for Ward Lenard method of speed control. Okay, I hope all these things are clear to you. So if you have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.